One way we can investigate what causes personality is through twin studies. These studies get at the whole issue of nature versus nurture, which has been big in developmental psychology. Twin studies are useful because they compare the personalities of twins who are identical twins or monozygotic twins to twins who are fraternal twins or dizygotic twins. Now, monozygotic twins share a lot more genetic material than dizygotic twins. That's because monozygotic twins come about from a single egg that's fertilized by a single sperm, whereas dizygotic twins are from two eggs and two sperm. What happens is, at some point early on, when the cells are separating, monozygotic twins come about because the group of cells split and two separate fetuses develop, whereas dizygotic twins are always two separate groups of cells developing into two fetuses in the placenta. Monozygotic twins often share a placenta, while dizygotic twins often have separate placentas. Now, it's not to say that monozygotic twins share 100% of genetic material, because there are some mutations that happen after cell separation. But they share a lot more genetic material than dizygotic twins. Dizygotic twins share the same amount of material as any two siblings who were born at any point in time. They are just two siblings who happen to be born very close in time. So we can compare the personalities of people who come from identical genetic backgrounds versus those who come from similar but not identical genetic backgrounds. It turns out sometimes twins are raised in the same family environment, and sometimes, for a whole variety of reasons, twins are separated and raised in different family environments. Telligan and colleagues conducted a study in 1988 where they looked at the similarities in personality between twins who were raised in the same family environment and those who were raised in different family environments. So they recruited twins who were reared together in the same family environment and twins who were reared apart. For those who were reared together, they recruited siblings who were either identical or fraternal twins. The same for those who were reared apart. These were the personality dimensions that the twins were compared on: anxiety proneness, aggression, alienation, impulse control, emotional well-being, traditionalism, and achievement orientation. Telligan and colleagues measured the correlations between the twins' scores on these dimensions. A larger number means that as one of the twins scored higher on a personality dimension, the more the other would score higher as well. And likewise, as one of the twins scored lower, the other would always tend to score lower. So the higher the correlation, the more similar the twins were on that personality dimension. A correlation of 0.52 is moderate to high, and suggests that as one twin scored higher on anxiety proneness, their twin sibling scored high on anxiety proneness as well. Looking at those correlations, what do you notice? Well, it seems fairly obvious that the identical twins were more similar to one another than the fraternal twins. The correlations for the identical twins are larger than the correlations for the fraternal twins. And this is the same whether they are reared together or apart. So the identical twins were similar to each other whether they were reared together or apart. These results suggest that genes are a relatively bigger contributor to personality than shared environment. Another thing to take notice here is that none of the correlations here are perfect. A perfect correlation is 1. The strongest correlation from these results is 0.61. If we work out the amount of variance explained by a correlation, by squaring the correlation, it works out to be 0.37, which means that genetics explains about a third of the shared variance in personality between identical twins. This leaves 2/3 of the variance unexplained, and it doesn't seem to be the shared environment. I'd like to tell you what it is, but nobody really knows for sure. Although the best guess at the moment is unshared environmental factors, such as going to different schools and so on. The point is that genes are a bigger contributor than shared environment, but they're not the only factor contributing to personality. Part of it might also come down to the idea that personality is really a function of the person and their environment, like the situation they're in. So the situation contributes to how personality is expressed. Here's another set of data that supports the same conclusion, which was published by Scar and colleagues in 1981. In this study, Scar and colleagues compared the personalities of mothers and their children, as well as the personalities between children. For some of the mother-child pairs, the children were biologically related to the mother, while others were adoptively related. For the pairs of children, some of the children were biologically related to the other children, while others were adoptively related. So the pairs who were biologically related were high in genetic similarity, while those who were adoptively related were low in genetic similarity. And in terms of environmental similarity, it was the opposite. Remember that the children in this study were adopted. So if they were biologically related to their mother or sibling, they grew up in a different environment. And if they were not biologically related, they were adopted into the family and they grew up in a similar environment to their adoptive mother or sibling. If we look at the correlation values between the pairs who were biologically related, the mother and child pairs scored a correlation of 0.21, while the sibling pairs scored 0.28. For those who were adoptively related, the mother and child pairs scored 0.12, and the sibling pairs scored only 0.05. The results from this study support the results from the twin studies, suggesting that genes contribute to personality more than the environment.